Brooke, if you're on Facebook and like our page, share it around, share the trade around YouTube, you porn, whatever you want to do. No, not you porn, we're not on you porn. You are, George. But,
I had hair, you won't recognise me. Anyway, they really just relax, enjoy the movie, yes. Have a wonderful time. We'll talk to you later.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Enjoy the show.
Okay, so we're here at the Perth premiere of Big Mama's Boy with the lead actor, Frank, and the director, Franco. Thanks very much for talking to us.
Pleasure.
So just tell us a little bit about the film to start off with.
Well,
Frank. Well, basically, it's Big Mama's Boy. It's about a 35-year-old Australian boy who happens to live at home with his overprotective, neurotic Italian mother. But you know he's got it good, so it's hard for him to leave. And he's a successful real estate agent, and he happens to meet a girl played by Holly Valance, and he falls in love and decides that he has to move out and become a man. So and that's when the fun starts, yeah, obviously.
So is there any art imitating life sort of scenario there? Because I was wondering when I was watching it, did any of those things with your mama happen?
Look, it's a very different story, but the whole scenario about wanting to leave home and the mother not wanting you to leave home, yes, there is some truth in that, and not just with me, but a lot of people I know and grew up with, yeah, definitely.
But it's a pretty universal situation. Like we've had Indian audience members and Chinese ones saying, we know a 40-year-old guy that's living at home with his mum. It's, you know, it happens in lots of cultures, but of course, the Italian one, the Big Mama's Boy, is the classic one. And, you know, the mama that we had really does it wonderfully well, which is Carmelina Di Guglielmo. It's one of the great mamas of the screen, I think.
Yeah, she was quite hilarious as well. So it's a 5 years in the making, this, from when you started. So what was the hardest bit about the whole production?
For me, I'd have to say two things, the writing and the acting were the hardest parts. Luckily, I had Franco, who was our script editor and helped us a lot in that process, in the writing, and also a director who helped me with my performance. So, I mean, if I had another director, I don't think I would have been as subtle and, you know, as consistent as I was in the film. If it was left up to me, I would have been over the top. And
no, there was a simple tip I gave them, which is I told Mama to treat Rocco like he was a 10-year-old boy. And as soon as she did that, the dynamic changed and it worked perfectly. And by the end of the film, though, they were talking to each other as adults. So he moved from being a dependent mama's boy to being an independent man worthy of something as gorgeous as Holly Valance.
Yeah, speaking of Holly, how did you manage to coax her into...
How did we score that?
we had a great meal with her. You know, you've got to use food to seduce people, yeah. Not like the film does. No, look, actually, Matteo and Frank always had their eye on her as an actress, so to speak. And Frank was touring, but Matteo and I met with her, had lunch with her. And, you know, look, admittedly, she was a bit nervous about doing the role. She didn't want to do another Wogboy thing. Not that there's anything wrong with that. I mean, Wogboy films are very successful. But she wanted to make sure she wasn't going to do something that's already been done before. So we met with her and explained our intentions, which was really to try and make a good romantic comedy. That was the bottom line. And it happened to be set in the Italo-Australian community.
Yeah. So when people are watching the film and they're about to, when they walk out of the cinema, what sort of feeling do you want them to have?
Oh, look, you know, we've had some screenings already, which has been overwhelming. The reaction is, you know, they come out, they're happy, they enjoy themselves, and that's the most important thing, that they can sort of escape for an hour and a half and have a good time. And I think we've achieved that.
Well, the crowd's still congregating from the screening, yeah, just over there, so they're definitely talking about,
yeah,
it.
And you know, because you know, they come and compliment you, and they tell you how great it was, and they want to shake your hand and take photos. So that's a good sign that they had a good time.
You know, yeah, what my telltale sign is? Yeah. That they actually watch the credits. How many films do you have where people stay and watch the credits? And I know we had the little, you know, visuals and the songs that went with it, but it's also the fact that it was a feel-good film, and people reveled in that, and they all fall in love with the characters and want to take them home, basically. And I think a part of that is that the way we did the comedy is to make everyone pretty innocent, so it becomes a comedy of errors rather than a calculated gag. And I think that comes out of the drama as opposed to going to try and make somebody laugh per se. So I think we went about it the right way, because being a romantic comedy, it's not just comedy, it's also drama. It's a hybrid, and you've got to make the drama work.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So filming, how long did filming take? And you filmed primarily in Melbourne or the whole thing in Melbourne?
Yeah, no, we filmed the whole thing in Melbourne, even the Sicily, the Italian scenes we filmed in Melbourne is in a great location. But look, it took about 6 weeks to shoot. We also were very lucky enough to have a couple of weeks rehearsal time with every actor, which was great, including Holly. And that was very important for us because we had such a short time to shoot the film. You know, 6 weeks is not a lot of time considering the Americans do it in 3 months. So, so very hard pressed for time.
Okay, so a question we like to ask everyone is, if you're on a desert island with a TV and a generator and a DVD player, what 3 movies would you pull out of your bag?
Yeah. I'll go first. Well, one of the films of the Taviani brothers, which would be La Notte di San Lorenzo, Night of Shooting Stars, one of my ever favorite films. But also I love Some Like It Hot. I could watch that over and over again. Great comedy. And I think probably A Touch of Evil. Funnily enough, so many of the films that I really love have Italian connections, and even A Touch of Evil, the music was done by Mancini, so there you go.
Yeah. Oh, look, there's my top three. I would have to say Cinema Paradiso, which is an Italian classic, only because it's a great film, but also it's one of my earliest memories is my parents taking me to the cinema as a kid, but taking me to the Italian cinemas, watching films dubbed in Italian, American films dubbed in Italian. So it's one of those things that's close to my heart. Another one would have to be Goodfellas, which is a different genre altogether, but the work of Martin Scorsese for me is just phenomenal. I really like that. And my third best would have to be Roberto Benigni's Life is Beautiful.
Yeah, well, funnily enough, there are a few cinematic tributes in the film from the Nino Rota sort of style of music that were used in the Fellini films, but even the Sergio Leone touch, which Frank wrote into the script, and then we realised that with sound effects and music as well. So, and for me, we tried to do something that the thing that I want to do, one of my favourite type of romantic comedies were the films of Rock Hudson and Doris Day. So it has a whole lot of different influences. Cinematic.
Homage to a few different films and genres in this film. So,
I wonder how many critics will pick up on that. Not one's mentioned it so far.
No, they don't see it. Well, that's all right. As long as the audiences enjoy it and they have a good time, that's all that matters. Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks so much for talking to us. Good luck with the release.
Pleasure.
And thanks very much.
Thank you. Cheers. Thank you. Thank you very much.